for pushing limits.
Hi, good afternoon. Good afternoon. This is Eddie Ituarte on Pushing Limits, along with Leah Gardner. Hi, Leah.
Hi, Eddie. How are you today?
I'm fair today. How's everything with you?
Not bad. Not bad. We have a lot to talk about today. We are going to be talking about the California state budget. And to talk with us about that, in just a few minutes, we're going to have Marty Omoto, who is executive director of CDCAN, the California Disability Community Action Network. But first, before we get started, there have been a lot of protests associated with the various budget cuts and proposed cuts in the state budget. And on February 18th, Pushing Limits producers John Healy and Adrian Lobby were out there to catch some of the action. So let's listen to some of the protest activity.
No more cuts! Make the bosses take the losses!
On February 18th, 100 or so people gathered in downtown San Francisco to protest proposed budget cuts to the California budget. These cuts affect people with disabilities, mental health issues, and seniors. Here's some of the sounds from the protest.
We need a system that supports people with disability and doesn't encourage people to have to go to institutions.
Julie Steinbeck owns a business that provides care for people with disabilities. We asked her what her feelings were as the budget negotiations dragged on. And then we talked to the mother of one of her clients who shared her feelings of outrage and fear. Here's Julie.
Outrage. Fear. I just don't know what's going to happen to my consumers. They could end up on the streets. We have a consumer with autism. And he needs 24 hours support. He's been living in his own apartment for 3 years. His parents don't know where he's going to go. And without our services, there would be no place for his parents to put him. They're elderly and they can't take care of him. He's violent.
He almost put us in our grave. It was pretty bad. And I fear for my husband more than myself. I don't ever fear my son because I work around him. But testosterone and testosterone don't work well together when your son is beating you up. He's doing this not because of Richard, it's because of his disability. And that you have to always keep that in mind. And that's tough. It's tough. I feel like the way he's placed now, I can die tomorrow and I know he'll be okay. Yes, we could have our son back home. It would be devastating. But what about all the others out there that do not have parents or relatives or anybody that could take them in? Are they to be left on the streets?
Take the losses, take the losses. Make the bosses take the losses. No spending caps. No spending caps.
People with disabilities, the blind, the lowest income seniors, they have cut them 16 times since 1991. The grants to the lowest income Californians. That's no longer a hard choice. We've become an easy target. And we need to fight back and to stand up for our community. They cannot do this to us anymore.
If the cuts are in the way, we're gonna roll right over them. Gonna roll the movement on. Gonna roll.
Okay, those are some of the voices from a February 18th demonstration. That was a little bit before the final budget was finalized by the legislature and the government and the governor. And to talk to us today is Marty Omoto from the California Disability Community Action Network. He's in Sacramento. Hi, Marty.
Hey, hi, Eddie and Adrian.
No, it's Leah.
It's Leah.
Yeah, so So that's good you're able to talk to us today, because during this whole process, people with disabilities, you know, we've been hearing different things. We've been hearing issues that perhaps our dental and eye care might be cut if on Medi-Cal. So why don't you just maybe summarize what actually happened with the budget, the final budget, and its effects on people with disabilities?
Sure. By the way, that February 18th protest was, about all the budget cuts, and there was, like you said, a nice sized crowd there outside the courthouse. It was also in support of the lawsuit to stop cuts to Medi-Cal and before the federal court, and we're waiting for the decision on that. But in terms of the budget, there's two pieces of the state budget. One, there's several cuts that are on hold. They were made, but they could be withdrawn if there's enough money coming from the federal government, and we're going to know that by or around April 1st, and I'll talk about that in a second. And the second are actually cuts that were approved and will go into effect July 1st, no matter what, no matter how much money comes to the state in terms of federal money, and or cuts that will be made, you know, this budget year now. And so I don't know what you want me to talk about. The Medi-Cal benefits that you're talking about regarding adult dental and about 10 other services, benefits, and they're called optional because the federal government doesn't require the states to provide them, but they're not optional in terms of people who desperately need these services. So it's, those will be eliminated effective July 1st during the, you know, the 2009-2010 budget year. Unless there's enough money that is coming from Washington, it's money coming out of what they call the federal stimulus bill that was signed by President Obama earlier. Yes. In February, and it's also other federal money that might be coming to the state. And so what has to happen is there's going to be a public hearing on March 17th here in Sacramento when the state treasurer, Bill Lockyer, and the governor's Department of Finance director, Mike Geness, will meet in a public meeting, so any of your listeners can attend here in Sacramento, and talk about whether or not there's enough federal money coming. And if there's enough federal money coming, then it would have to add up to about $10 billion. Not about, it actually has to add up to $10 billion. Then that cut, along with some other cuts, would not happen. The other cuts that would not happen if there's enough federal money coming is a cut to IHSS, in-home supported services, and also a reduction to the grant levels of SSI, SSP, that's the Supplemental Security Income, state supplemental payment program for the lowest income people with disabilities, seniors, and the blind. There's a cut to that grant level. Those two cuts would not happen if $10 billion in federal money would be coming to California that they could count to replace state funds.
So people that are receiving the 907 at this time, it still may they'll still receive all that 907.
You're talking about the SSI SSP payment,
right?
Yes. Though there's a catch to that too. There's never been a budget like this where, first of all, they passed a budget that's early, meaning a budget that's really that doesn't begin until July. They passed that early. They're also making cuts to the current budget, and then they have these various cuts that could take place but maybe won't. So you have the cut to SSI, SSP that won't take effect if there's enough federal money coming. But that's to the grant level, reducing it back, cutting it by 2.3%. So that may or may not happen. I don't think it will happen, but we're going to have to fight, to make sure that doesn't happen. However, if that doesn't happen, what will happen to SSI, SSP, there will be another cut, though. And that will be a suspension, meaning a suspension or a cut of the cost of living that is owed to people receiving SSI, SSP that is due next year in May, and also what was due, what you received in January as of January 1st will be taken back as of May 1st. So it's sort of like it's almost like pick your poison. On one level, we, you know, some cuts will go away if there's enough federal money, but if those cuts go away, there's still these other cuts that will go forward.
Marty, just in...
And it sounds complicated, but it's...
In tangible terms, if those cuts, some of those cuts don't go through, if there's enough money received from the federal government, can you give us an idea, just in individual terms, with suspending the cost of living increase and taking it back, what that is going to mean in dollars for people?
Well, it would vary. It could be $30 to $40. I don't have the exact amount because it would vary on what a person's grant level was.
Okay.
But to the outside community, you know, who don't depend on a fixed amount of money to live on, it may not seem a lot, but it's a lot of money when you add it up, especially when it's, you know, per month, and you're not going to ever get that money back. And when you add it up to other cuts that are occurring, you know, to our community. So it would vary depending on your grant level, on the SSI, SSP grant level. But it's significant because, as I had said before, at rallies and protest rallies, the state has cut the cost of living. That's money that's owed to people who receive SSI, SSP, because the other costs have gone up. So this money is owed to people receiving SSI, SSP for the state part of that grant. It's been cut 16 times since 1991, and they're going to cut it again for next year, the money that's due for next year. They've already cut it this year. So people, what you would normally get an increase in June, that's not going to happen because of the last year's budget. So add those up. If you add $10 here per month that you might have gotten as an increase, or, you know, $20 there in terms of a federal, some other increase, it starts adding up because that's the per month cost or increase or money that someone needs. And if other costs weren't going up, I guess, you know, the state can make the argument that no one's being harmed. But we know that's not true.
Another system that really took some major cuts in the latest budget is regional centers.
Right.
Can you talk a little bit about what that's going to mean to those centers and to the individuals and family members who rely on them?
It's pretty devastating. There will be a cut this year in the current year budget of 3% to money that's paid to regional center-funded community-based providers who, you know, fund all kinds of different types of programs, including people who actually provide staff and support for someone to live in their own home. So a provider would end up receiving 3% less, you know, for their costs. That's for this year, and it goes into next year. On top of that, the state has already cut $100 million in state funds. It's probably closer to almost $200 million if you add up lost federal funds that will cover all of next year in addition to the 3% reduction. And the details of how that cut will impact people is still not known. That's being worked out right now. But it's pretty tremendous because what it will mean, though, is that community-based services are going to be severely impacted because it's taking a pretty dramatic hit at a time when the economy is bad and other costs are rising. So that has already happened, and that hit or that cut will happen regardless of how much other federal money is coming to the state.
Are people going to end up losing their potentially being unable to live in their own apartments or homes because of these cuts?
We think that's a definite threat because providers that provide the supports and services that help a person remain in their own home are not going to be able, there's many who won't be able to survive this, especially if they end up cutting reimbursements to providers even more. So that's a real threat. And then, of course, we have the threat of cuts to in-home supportive services that if that goes through, if there's not enough federal money, that's obviously going to impact a person's right to live in their own home. And of course, the Medi-Cal cuts as well. So, you know, our community is facing a lot of different threats, some of them that are already happening, and some of them we don't know if they're going to happen or not. And then we face another threat on May 19th, which is a special election. And on the ballot is a spending cap limit, which sounds like a really, you know, it doesn't sound very harmful, but it's a change in the state constitution that would require the state to limit what it spends based on how much it brought in over the past previous 10 years. What that will do, though, is limit spending on critical health and human service programs like, you know, supportive services, regional centers, mental health, and that's going to have a devastating impact, and that would go into effect for the next budget year. So our community is facing a number of threats in the coming months and the coming years.
So your organization, California Disability Community Action Network, is going to be actively fighting against this initiative?
Yes, and it's a kind of a, you know, lose-lose position. I mean, we're opposed to it, and I think that some other other disability groups are opposed to it. However, if it loses, the way they wrote the budget language, the legislature and the governor, is that if it loses, then the tax increases that went into effect for 4 years would only go into effect for two. So, in other words, within 2 years, the revenues would drop back down to the point that the state would probably have to make more cuts. So we're stuck in the rock and the hard place. But rather fight that battle than fight a constitutional amendment that would actually limit funding. It limits funding based on the kind of a false assumption that somehow the growth in our system in services is somehow, I mean, as if we can control the numbers of people who are disabled or grow old or have mental health needs. And I think the state is wrong to assume that there's a connection between the growth rate there and the growth rate in the regular population. I mean, it's not recognizing or placing the value on human lives that what is what this state should be about.
Okay. So Marty, maybe we might want to look at it from the other part, you know, the revenue part. And so, like, I was just looking through something put out by California Tax Reform Association, which is not a Jarvis Prop 13 kind of thing. I mean, it's a progressive.
Yeah, Lenny Goldberg.
Yeah, and they've actually come up with all kinds of recommendations on how to enhance taxes, and a lot of it are built around corporate taxation,
right,
and their breaks and stuff. And then I also got a figure that since that there has been a cut in rates in corporate taxes. And since if you had applied the same rate back into 1981 because of cuts, that we lose about $8.4 billion a year. The point I'm making is that should disability organizations and other organizations be joining up with other progressive groups, not only involved in disability, and as part of our political program, push for more higher taxation, make it more equitable?
Yeah, or maybe even the broader message that there's other ways to balance this, you know, the state's budget, and you know, and that the state hasn't gone after other solutions. They do what is easiest, which is go after our community. And you know, if we look back at when the budget problems happened back in 2001, every year since then, except for this year, the only solution in the budget was either massive cuts, which they did, and some borrowing, and never to raise revenues. In fact, they cut revenues when the governor came in with the vehicle license fee. So they actually cut revenues and then made cuts to our community at the same time. And so this is the first year they actually raised revenues, and our argument is that the state needs to, you know, make the hard choices that it places on us. They need to place those hard choices on the rest of California. As well, and which includes looking at raising revenues and being creative, and also as Lenny Goldberg's group has come up with, looking at better ways to raise revenues. Because cutting services and cutting programs isn't just about, you know, cutting someone's money, a provider, or as you were saying, it really is about, you know, how does that impact a person's ability to live in their own home, which is a right. It's not just a privilege. It's a right for someone to live in their own home or in their own community. And what does that mean when you cut, you know, someone's wage or reimbursement? It means that can't happen, or you cut their health care. So I think you're right to raise it in very human terms, and that's what we're trying to do too, is that these aren't just budget cuts to some faceless provider groups. It's budget cuts to Californians with a face, you know, and a voice. But unfortunately, that voice is not always there at the Capitol, and that's what we're trying to change.
Well, is that what's happening here? I mean, you talk about these cuts happening over a long period of time. Why has the disability and senior community become so vulnerable every single time that we're looking at how we're going to balance the budget, how are we going to close this deficit? Why is it always these communities that are targeted? Is it not enough presence at the polls? Is it not enough advocacy? What's going on?
Well, we have a presence at the polls, I think. The problem is we don't have a presence after that happens. And you don't have to belong to a union, or you don't have to be, you know, have a lot of money to be effective in terms of holding our policymakers, the legislators, accountable. But I go to meetings and I ask this question to audiences who they all, you know, claim to have voted and they registered to vote. And everyone understands that as a civic right and as a responsibility. And even a few will go to budget hearings. But almost nobody raises their hand when I ask the question, do you know how your legislator voted on Medi-Cal, on in-home supportive services, on access rights or anything? No one knows. So, I mean, in other words, we elect people into office. If you're a Democrat, you vote for Democrats. If you're a Republican, you vote for Republican. And we never worry about how they vote, you know, what they do there. And, but you know what? Other groups do. Teachers do. Other areas of the budget, people react. And if they vote the wrong way, those legislators hear about it. When legislators vote the wrong way, you know, regarding our community, they don't really hear about it. Not from the people who voted them into office. So everyone who's listening and every one of us needs to ask, do you know how your legislator voted on cuts to Medi-Cal last year, last September, or how they voted this year on IHSS or regional centers or mental health? And the answer probably is that most people don't know. And if you don't know, then the legislator is getting away with it. Never mind the governor, who should not have proposed these things in the first place, but your own legislator is getting away with it if you're not asking, if we're collectively not asking those questions and at least holding them accountable.
Would we be potentially in a better situation if we didn't have a constitutional amendment that required two-thirds of the Senate to approve of any legislation before it becomes passed?
Well, that's both houses, the Assembly and the State Senate, and two-thirds to pass a budget or to raise taxes. Yeah, it would make things definitely, you wouldn't have the stalemate, you know, the long delays as we have seen over the past several years. It solves that problem. It doesn't necessarily solve the issue of us getting cut, though. Because, again, any human being, you don't have to be a bad human being, but you can be a human being that just wants to do the easiest thing. And if no one is complaining, if all you have to do is face an angry crowd of people at a budget hearing and you can vote to cut that group and never hear from them again until the next budget, you know, hearing, as opposed to getting phone calls, letters, visits from, you know, teachers or other groups, what group will you cut? And the fact that also teachers give enormous campaign contributions, that helps too. But we also make it easy for legislators to make cuts on us because we never question them as individuals on how they voted. That's one step, and you're right about the other one. Lowering the threshold of, you know, how you pass a budget will mean that it can't be held hostage too. And so that's another important reform that needs to happen.
Well, it would seem that Democrats, that would be one of the priority things on the agenda at the legislative level, so they can't use that excuse for a compromise. And we saw them compromise in this budget process, so they allowed for more corporate tax breaks. They allowed for this really dreadful primary initiative,
right,
where it's if it passes, it's going to really hurt third parties. So the Democrats really did some crummy things, and I don't hear them right now trying to do something about this two-thirds stuff on passing the budget.
Yeah, there's an effort to place something on the ballot, you know, to lower that threshold. And you're right. It actually causes people that we might consider to be our friends to end up compromising in ways that maybe they wouldn't feel the need to, and which means like cutting our programs and services or not doing things right regarding raising revenues. You're absolutely right. I mean, that's part of the, I mean, it would help a lot. It doesn't solve all the problem, but it would definitely help a lot. So whether that gets on the ballot or not eventually, probably not until 2010, but definitely it would make a difference or start making a difference. But on the other hand, before that happens, you know, the spending cap, initiative is on the ballot for May 19th. If that passes, we're going to be in trouble no matter what happens, you know, if we lower the threshold of how you pass a budget. Because the state will be under a state constitutional requirement to limit spending. You know, so that's going to be a major threat to our communities in the coming months, coming years, too.
So let me just ask you how it seems like, in terms of lawmakers right now, we're vulnerable because on some level we don't matter like some other groups do because we're not following up. What can we do right now that might start to change that trend?
I would urge all your listeners to first find out who their legislator is, because a lot of people don't know. In fact, most Californians don't know who their legislator is, their state legislator. And then I would call them and, you know, contact them, not here in the Capitol, but in your own community, because they have offices in your own community there, and ask them how they voted on the budget regarding cuts to Medi-Cal, cuts to IHSS, cuts to a lot of these. Now, some legislators actually did the right thing. They actually voted no. But enough voted yes. Democrats as well as enough Republicans voted yes so that these were actually put in the budget. But a few actually did vote no all the way through. So, you know, for those people, obviously, we need to thank those people. And it was a difficult decision for some others because, you know, the state did need a budget. So that was the other problem. That's where that two-thirds problem, as you were mentioning, Eddie, plays into this compromising that ends up hurting us. So, but I think people need to find out, you know, these people work for us. You know, in our represent our communities in the legislature, and so at the very least, we need to know how they voted, and did they actually vote to cut our programs, or did they vote to oppose those cuts? And if they voted to cut our programs or cut Medi-Cal, then at the very least, we should ask for them to explain why they did that.
Marty, you provide an email list for people to get updates on current legislative situations. How can people subscribe to that?
It's free, just go to the website or www.cdcan.us, and there's a little thing you can click on to just sign up. These are email reports on what is happening in terms of disability-related and senior-related and mental health-related budget issues, but also legislation or other related issues that occur at the state level. Some federal level. It's hard to track all the federal stuff, too. But the idea was, you know, to get as much information out to our communities, and then hopefully around information we can kind of unite. But I wanted to treat our community with the same respect that it deserves, because I just always felt that other communities are given inside information on what's happening, and our community is not.
And on that note, I think it's unfortunately time for us to go.
Yeah.
There's so much to deal with, and thank you so much, Marty, for helping us sort some of it out. Thank you, Eddie, for co-hosting with me today.
You're welcome.
I'm Leah Gardner. Thank you to the entire Pushing Limits crew and Adrian Lobby and John Healy for the live report that we had today. And thanks, Deb Ross, for the engineering. We will see you in 2 weeks. Stay tuned for Cover to Cover Open Book. Thanks. See you next time.
Keep on pushing. I've got to keep on pushing.
KPFA, 60 years, 60 voices. Paul Krugman.
So the U.S. and Canada in the 1960s, in both countries, about 30% of workers were in unions. In Canada, it's still almost 30%. In the U.S., of course, is down to about 11 and mostly in public sector. How did that happen? Well, what happened was that the federal government basically turned anti-union. It declared open season for employers trying to block union organizers. Now that looks to me like manipulation of the system on behalf of the rich.
In celebration of 60 years of broadcasting, KPFA has assembled recordings of many of the influential people who have graced the KPFA.